Shalom. This week's Torah portion is Parashat Mishpatim, the sixth Torah portion in the book of Shemot, Exodus, beginning in chapter 21. In last week's Torah portion of Yitro, we learned about the spectacular event of Ma'amad Har Sinai, the soaring spiritual experience of the giving of the Torah at Mount Sinai. All of Israel ascended to the highest level of prophecy and perceived with perfect clarity that Hashem is one and that He is the sum total of reality. It was the most dramatic, uplifting, mind-bending, and powerful event in history. The voice of Hashem was heard. The sound of the shofar and the lightning was seen and heard. The mountain was fire and smoke. And all of this transcending the limitations of the physical senses. The whole world was shaking in awe, and the earth stood at attention as the children of Israel received the Torah at Mount Sinai. Thus, we may have expected that our portion this week, which opens with the nation still standing at Sinai, would begin with something transcendental, totally spiritual, focusing on some aspect of man's direct relationship with the Creator or his worship to follow up on the rarefied level of revelation that we just experienced. But as our parsha opens, Mishpatim, we see that the Torah has clearly been brought down to earth. The new level of knowledge acquired at Sinai brought responsibility for the individual, for community, for society, for the entire world. Mishpatim means ordinances, and our portion opens as we are still standing at Sinai with the words, "And these are the ordinances that you shall place before them." The connecting letter Vav is used, "and these are the ordinances," because these laws are a direct continuation of the Ten Commandments and the entire Torah that was revealed and given at Sinai. So our Parshat Mishpatim is a continuation of this process of receiving Torah. This portion of Mishpatim features 53 commandments, 23 positive and 30 negative. A proper study of each of these mitzvot and understanding their meaning and practical application in our world is beyond the scope of our time today. They directly address the full spectrum of the highs and lows of the human condition, forming the foundation of the bedrock of society, laws that focus on personal and communal responsibility, laws that pertain to righting wrongs committed against others, laws that pertain to people and their possessions, what happens when someone's property damages someone else's on purpose or inadvertently, or a situation wherein a person's behavior has unfairly caused someone else to suffer some sort of loss or harm, perhaps even accidental death, monetary laws, stealing, and how to set things right, the judicial process. These laws are all designed by Hashem as the foundation of a healthy society, taking place not in heaven, from where the laws originate, but here on earth. And so suddenly we seem to be very far from heavenly visions, from the rarefied states of consciousness and revealed esoteric knowledge that we spoke about last week in Parshat Yitro that characterized the Sinai revelation experience. But heaven is not that far from earth, not disconnected from it, and certainly not unconcerned with it. The ordinances of Parshat Mishpatim are what ground the Sinai experience into this world. The commandments that Moshe is given here by God to teach the people are earthbound, solid, societal, people-oriented, as humanly centered as can be. No spiritual exercise is prescribed here, but rules for how people should treat each other. Hashem's voice is transmuted into caring about others. So there's a lot to receive and a lot to learn. Torah observance is not a once-a-week thing or reserved for special occasions. Now we are receiving details of what this commitment entails, because Hashem has decreed for this fledgling nation to become a model nation, if they get their act together. A nation that lives with God in its midst, in keeping with Hashem's promise that He stated right before the giving of the Torah. And now, if you hearken well to me and observe my covenant, you shall be to me the most beloved treasure of all peoples, for mine is the entire world. You shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, back in chapter 19. What is the intention of Hashem's metaphor here, a kingdom of priests? We're not all priests. But just as within the body of Israel, the Kohanim, the priestly family descended from Aaron, are entrusted with bringing Hashem's light and blessing to the nation, so too, within the body of mankind, all of Israel is collectively the Kohen, ministering to humanity, entrusted with bringing Hashem's light and blessing to the entire world. It's precisely the Torah's attention to the nitty-gritty details of our very earthly existence that brings Hashem's voice, the voice that emanated from Sinai and was heard around the world, brings that voice into the world. God cares so much about this world that he continues to be involved with it. He didn't just create it and walk away. He continues to maintain an intimate relationship, caring, concerned with the affairs of men and their conduct. And this is what makes all the difference in the world when posing the question that each of us must ask ourselves, what in the world am I doing in this world? If it's a purposeful, God-driven world, that means that I'm not a passerby, but I must take my place in that world and answer the call of purposeful creation. And this is what belief in the Sinai revelation and the divine origin of Torah really means on a practical level. And open up your heart in the deepest way. A person can be very spiritual, removed from this world, and can be given over to meditation and contemplation all day long. But the measure of a person is how he or she behaves towards others. It's easy for us to convince ourselves that we're close to God if we isolate ourselves in a room and have no dealings with people. But how we treat others is the only true measure of whether or not we're connected to Hashem in this world. A life of commitment to the mitzvot, the commandments, is the true spiritual experience because it's in this world, it's this world that Hashem loves. And if we get high from a mystical experience, but we're not completely honest in business, or if we behave improperly in our relationships, or if we're insensitive or mean-spirited, we have no relationship with God. A person can consider themselves holy, but if their ears and eyes don't hear and see the suffering of others, their ears and eyes are not holy. So what part of them is holy? Parashat Mishpatim clearly illustrates that the Torah is about this world. So whoever thinks that God doesn't care about these details does not know Torah and does not know God. And we can suspect that if we were granted a look behind the curtains to see what kind of person they really are, we may be disappointed. Because such arrogant rationalization is usually the sign of a narcissistic life, self-centered and focused on self-gratification, sometimes masquerading in the garb of religion or hiding behind that world as a pretext to the abrogation of responsibility. So open up your heart. The truly sensitive human being who could be called religious is a person who knows how and is willing to translate his love of God and commitment to divine principles into practical application in this world, as in how we treat others. In a Torah mindset, that's a true religious experience. If a person can't translate love for God into practical application as love for man, maybe he loves imagining that he loves God, but he doesn't love God or man. Open up your heart, because this is the Torah's intention. How else can we prove that our humanity can be instilled with godliness other than by our behavior reflecting God's presence in every aspect of our lives, in a very human world for which the Torah was intended? The Parsha opens with these words, and these are the ordinances that you shall set before them. Should you buy a Hebrew slave, he shall work for 6 years, and in the seventh year, he shall go out to freedom without charge. The first of these mishpatim, these ordinances, these laws, is the law of the Eved Ivri, the Hebrew servant. This is a dejected individual who works for another, for a master, for 6 years, and he can go free in the seventh year. He's sold into service, not as a punishment, but as recompense for stealing, or perhaps to escape from extreme financial hardship. And according to Torah law, this individual is to be treated by his master with respect, mercy, and kindness. This is so different from the modern contemporary penal system, which fosters and breeds and perpetuates crime. The Hebrew servant's master must provide for his servant and for his entire family for the duration of his service. The Talmud clarifies that the master must care for his servant even more than he cares for himself. For example, if the master only has one pillow, he must give it to his servant. Or if the master has only one bed, he must give it to his servant, and he himself must sleep on the floor. Our sages ponder the question, why did Parshat Mishpatim begin with the ordinance of the Eved Ivri, the Hebrew slave? There are many beautiful and compelling interpretations. But open your heart in the deepest way, because on the most basic level, it all goes back to Adam, the world's first thief, who took what he was commanded not to take. And all of us all the time, we're always trying to fix that. So this Parsha, the first practical application of Torah in this world after it was revealed at Mount Sinai, starts with an individual being sold as a servant, just like Adam HaRishon. Adam, the first man, starting off in this world. At the Sinai revelation, the entire nation heard Hashem's declaration of his presence in the form of the first commandment, Anochi, I am Hashem your God, which anchored the love of Hashem deeply within our hearts. The children of Israel knew then so clearly that there's nothing else. On the deepest inner level, they knew that they would never have any desire for anything else. And that utterance, it continues to echo from Sinai, and it's never ceased to reverberate throughout the world every day. But how do we hear it? How do Hashem's 10 utterances, the 10 commandments, take form and shape in this world? Hashem's word filters down into our world, the world he created and placed us in order for us to serve him by working on ourselves to become better people, this world of action. His word takes shape in the ordinances of the Torah. And everything, every situation, every relationship, every transaction, every opportunity, like the situations described taking place between people in Parashat Mishpatim, this stuff of life, these ordinary situations, whatever we confront is a manifestation of Hashem's infinite light filtering down into this world, into vessels. Everything is like a garment, like a vessel for the light that is hidden. And the first mishpat, the ordinance of the Hebrew servant, cloaks the light in the first of the Ten Commandments. I am Hashem, your God, who took you out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. Open up your heart in the deepest way. This ordinance beckons to both the servant and his master that they're being presented with an opportunity to fix themselves. When a person steals, what is the root of his sin? He forgets temporarily that he's standing face to face opposite Hashem, and it's Hashem who provides for him, who gives him everything. And instead of acknowledging him and thanking him for all the good, he tries to strong arm, he tries to grab from the back door, thinking no one's looking. He thinks that if he doesn't grab for himself, he's not going to have from what to live. And therefore his tikkun, his fixing, is to be sold for his stealing into service. But this is not a punishment. It's a chance Hashem is giving him to internalize the magnitude of his relationship with God, his true master, because he acted as if he didn't believe that he could receive his needs directly from Hashem himself. He was worried about where his next meal is coming from. So now as his rectification, he has to be under a master, and the master will receive on his behalf. But from this experience, he'll understand his failing and how to fix it. These 6 years become a workshop. And all of our lives are workshops. Every changing, fluid human situation that involves our interaction with others and in every aspect of our lives is a manifestation of Hashem's announcement of Anochi, I am, being filtered through the vessels of our everyday lives, our everyday experiences. And who is truly a servant and who is truly free? The sages teach, who is a free man? One who is in servitude to the Torah. Later on in Parashat Kitisa, in Exodus chapter 32, the Torah records that the script of God was engraved on the tablets, and in Hebrew the phrase is charut al haluchot, which literally means engraved on the tablets. However, the Torah actually features no vowels, and the same word charut, engraved, can also be read as cherut, freedom. And thus our sages render this homiletical interpretation as freedom on the tablets. Freedom comes through accepting our responsibility to Hashem, because who is a free man? Freedom doesn't mean that I can do whatever I want. Torah defines freedom as the ability to choose between right and wrong. Freedom, true freedom, is about being free, and only through my subservience to Hashem will I ever become free from my own yetzer hara, my evil inclination, which constantly contorts my conception of myself and of reality and retards my spiritual growth into a caring person by keeping me focused on the pettiness associated with my base physical nature. True freedom is being free from the persecutor within. The Sinai experience was so powerfully transformative, it was such a clear vision of what reality really is, that cognizance and conviction of its having taken place, which is of course synonymous with the acceptance of the divine origins of the Torah, that recognition is the linchpin of what it really means for each and every one of us to accept the Torah in our personal lives. Towards the end of our portion concerning the covenant described in chapter 24, we read, Moshe took half the blood and placed it in basins, and half the blood he threw upon the altar. He took the book of the covenant and he read it within the earshot of the people, and they said, everything that Hashem has said, we will do and we will obey. Moshe took the blood and threw it upon the people, and he said, behold, the blood of the covenant that Hashem sealed with you concerning all these matters. Moshe, Aaron, Nadav and Avihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel ascended. They saw the God of Israel, and under his feet was the likeness of sapphire brickwork, and it was like the essence of the heaven in purity. What happened here? Whatever the vision was that Israel perceived, they saw the God of Israel, and under his feet was the likeness of sapphire brickwork, and it was like the essence of the heaven in purity. Clearly, this has no simple meaning. They saw the God of Israel, under his feet was the likeness of sapphire brickwork. How could we begin to understand just what it was that the people saw? Later in this very book of Shemot, in Parashat Ki Tisa, Hashem warns them in Exodus chapter 33, "No man sees my face and lives." And again, in Moshe's review of this event in Deuteronomy chapter 4, we are reminded that no image or form was seen. So open up your heart in the very deepest way ever. Our sages teach that this imagery was designed by Hashem, was tailor-made for Israel to relate to within their comfort zone. Why utilize a brick motif in proximity to God himself? Because remember that just a few months earlier, these folks were slaves to Pharaoh, and they were forced to make bricks. So these are people who know bricks. And God is saying he knows that, and it means a lot to him. This making of bricks must be very precious to him. If the bricks are under his feet, he really cares about and is intimately involved with what goes on in this world. But the slave labor bricks manufactured by Israel in Egyptian bondage was used by the king of Egypt to build up his own might. And the message of this vision is that now they will be accomplishing something entirely different through their service, their labor. Now that they're in the service of Hashem, the true king, all their actions, how they deal with every very human situation, all the commandments that are detailed in this parsha, these deeds reflecting a life lived in accordance with Hashem's will become bricks, as it were, building up Hashem's kingdom on this earth, reflecting his presence, and by Israel's response of we will do and we will obey, they made the first brick in the covenant. But Hashem compassionately showed them that the brickwork was made of sapphire, because everything we do in this world, all the material, all the earthbound details become connected to heaven. Perhaps we can say that the beauty of this vision which God provided for Israel was the glimpse it afforded them that Hashem so identifies with this world of action, this material world of bricks. But now that Israel has accepted responsibility for accepting Torah, and thus by so doing accepted responsibility for the welfare of the world, rather than serving Pharaoh, they are now serving the Almighty Creator. And the bricks they are creating through their deeds, through living a life of dedication to Hashem's word and will, those bricks, tempered by heaven and rendered sapphire-like, and as a reflection of the tablets themselves that were made of sapphire, unlike Pharaoh's bricks of futility, these bricks are under his feet. They become the foundation of the world, what holds the world up. And those actions imbue this very physical world of action into something meaningful, lasting, eternal, spiritually powered, and most importantly, a reflection of God's presence. Please remember to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. If you enjoy these presentations and benefit from these teachings, please consider helping Jerusalem Lights with your support. Only your support enables these broadcasts to continue and grow.